Many of the films that were produced during this period delighted in the shattering of taboos. Comedy was not immune to this ambition. Just 2 years earlier, Mel Brooks had found humor in Hitler with the producers. On February 4th of 1970, Start the Revolution Without Me found laughs in the violent arena of the French Revolution.
Start the Revolution Without Me. Gene Wilder.
Out of the producers, remember?
I don't find that amusing.
Donald Sutherland.
Oh, there. Do be gracious.
Start the Revolution Without Me.
Filmed almost entirely in Paris, Start the Revolution Without Me is a farcical tale of mistaken identity. Two sets of identical twins are separated at birth. One set, Felipe and Pierre d'Assisi, are aristocrats and master swordsmen.
What's he saying?
He wants us to betray the king and align ourselves with him.
He has a secret plan which only you can uncover.
And what is the reward for this treachery?
Half of France.
And for my brother?
The other set, Charles and Claude, are nitwits who live a life of peasantry.
Born on that rainy night 30 years ago, Claude and Charles Coupé, orphaned in youth, living by their wits. They were dragooned into the cause of the rebels. Lovers of liberty, they knew no liberty.
On the eve of the French Revolution, one set is mistaken for the other. And of course, hijinks ensue.
Listen, maybe we can fool some servants, but what are we going to do tonight at that ball?
If you believe you're a d'Assisi, they'll believe you're a d'Assisi.
If I believe, I'm going to get my head chopped off.
I said we do not wish to be disturbed. Out!
What was I just talking about?
The film was scripted by Fred Freeman and Lawrence J. Cohen, a collaboration that would continue over the course of four feature films from 1970 to 1991. Both writers started in the world of television comedy, penning material for The Andy Griffith Show, The Dick Van Dyke Show, and Gilligan's Island. But when they attempted to pitch their own ideas to the networks, their oddball, outside-the-box approach to comedy proved too daring and risque for the time.
I think we both had a similar point of view. We both enjoyed satire, you know.
Co-screenwriter Fred Freeman.
Like CBS always says, we love the guy. You guys did the funniest pilots, but we'll never put them on the air.
While Freeman and Cohen might not have been embraced by television networks for their bold ideas, writer, producer, director Norman Lear and producer, director Bud Yorkin were. Together, through their partnership titled Tandem Productions, they managed to change the face of television in the 70s. With back-to-back hit shows, including All in the Family, The Jeffersons, Maude, Good Times, and Sanford and Son. But in the decade prior to these now classic shows, Lear and Yorkin ventured into the world of feature films, which led to early efforts like Come Blow Your Horn and Divorce American Style. Both men were enthusiastic about bringing Start the Revolution Without Me to the big screen.
Norman Lear came to us. He had an idea that about how about doing a movie about two sets of twins that get mixed up at birth and during the Civil War. And so I said, well, it sounds, two sets of twins who get mixed up, sounds more like Molière, so why don't we do it in the French Revolution?
Oh, wow.
You know, which it did sound like, you know what I mean, when you get into that kind of farce.
Start the Revolution Without Me would be Fred Freeman and Lawrence Cohen's first feature film. Once the contracts were in place, Lear was on board to executive produce, with Yorkin taking over producing and directing duties.
Everyone warned us about Yorkin and Lear, oh, they're going to redo the whole thing. Well, Norman never touched it at all, you know. And he said, years later, he said it was always one of the best comedy screenplays he ever read.
In addition to the casting of Gene Wilder and Donald Sutherland as the two, or rather four, leads, the ensemble featured a who's who of terrific character actors.
Well, how far did your involvement go with Start the Revolution Without Me? Were you present for the filming at all?
We went over there for 2 weeks. They paid us to go for 2 weeks only.
Okay.
You know, in case we did I can't even remember. We probably did a little bit of rewriting, and at least we got to Europe for a couple of weeks. We couldn't tell. There was a table reading, which had the one wonderful English actors, Victor Spinetti. No one knows who he is, but he was very funny. Billy Whitelaw was a well-known actress. Hugh Griffith was a well-known actor. Hugh Griffith played the king, and the problem with Hugh Griffith was he was drunk a lot. And he had just been fired off of a previous picture. So they hired, to do Start the Revolution, I think they hired a bodyguard, a valet bodyguard, and paid his wife also to, you know, watch him. And, of course, in the middle of the movie, they come into his dressing room and all three of them are drunk. So.
The film also featured none other than Orson Welles, the genius giant of cinema, who lent authentic gravitas to the film's opening setup.
Hello. I'm Orson Welles. Lovely, isn't it? The summer palace of Louis XVI. You know, historians have recently discovered a previously unknown fact concerning this palace. An event which almost changed the entire history of Western Europe. Did you know that the entire French Revolution could have been avoided?
It's true.
No one knows what took place there. It's an event of such importance that men of integrity, and I may say of considerable resources, have made a film on the subject. It's a color film, which I am not in.
The opening of the movie had Orson Welles narrating it. And the original script he would not do, we didn't know this at the time, the original script, as he was narrating, he's romping on these beautiful grounds with these gorgeous hound dogs all over the place. And halfway through the narration, you don't see anything, but you obviously know he stepped in shit. Dog shit. And so the rest of the narration was he was trying to scrape off his shoe as he was narrating. And I think it would have worked, but he refused to do it.
The King's Summer Palace, 1789. King Louis, whose tinkering with timepieces did not tell him his own time was running out. Queen Marie tinkered with everything but timepieces. She didn't care what time it was. But the evil escargot knew what time it was. His tinkering was well-timed. For the time was 1789.
Perhaps what's most impressive about the film, beyond its authentic setting and meticulously detailed costuming, is the sophistication of its wordplay, especially as it's recited by the sly and manic Wilder and the more reserved and effeminate Sutherland.
In honor, sir.
What brings you to Paddock?
Oh, you might say a little business.
And a little pleasure.
Which do you prefer, business or pleasure?
Well, that depends on what you regard as business.
And what you may regard as pleasure.
In Paris, we say business is pleasure.
Well, to us, pleasure is our business.
Then your business should be a pleasure, making my pleasure a business.
Unless some mistake business for pleasure, while others know no business but pleasure.
In that case, sir, I will show you my business.
My pleasure.
Gene had just come off doing The Producers, so it was his third movie.
Author of Gene Wilder, Funny and Sad, Brian Scott Mednick.
In France, and Gene was a real Francophile, so he just loved the filming of Start the Revolution, and he was married to his second wife, and he brought her and his the wife's daughter, who he adopted, Katie, there. So, but Jorgen said he just loved when they weren't filming, you know, finding little out-of-the-way restaurants and new French wines. And Gene Wilder was actually a very good fencer. You know, he said everyone was stunned when he got into these sword fights. He said all of a sudden Gene became an animal. He went to the Old Vic Theatre School in Bristol, England, and he learned fencing there. And he also, there's a lot of fencing in his first movie, The Director, The Adventure of Sherlock Holmes' Smarter Brother. So it was a good experience for him. The film actually did open to a lot of positive reviews, but it wasn't a hit, Yorkin said, because Bud Yorkin did not have a good relationship with someone at the studio, and it didn't get basically the publicity that it should have. But it's considered today what's known as a cult classic. And people who really love the movie, and there are a lot of them, they're crazy about it. And Bud Yorkin said to me, I interviewed him in 1996, and he said he'd go to universities to talk about, you know, he thought all the questions were going to be about All in the Family. And, you know, people were asking him about Start the Revolution Without Me. So it's a great film. I think it was very underrated and underseen for a long time, but thanks to home video and DVDs, it's a very accessible film, and I think a lot of people have discovered it.
And it's such an unusual setting for the kind of comedy it is, too. It's just an unusual, unique movie that feels something that requires some time to catch on.
Yeah, I remember first seeing it on television when I was very young, and I liked it right away. I mean, I saw it many times after that, and it's a film that really benefits from repeated viewings. It's a really funny, well-made film.
I like this plan. Half of France will soon be ours.
Why settle for half when all of France can be ours?
All of France. Yes. We don't need escargot.
Exactly.
Exactly. All the castles.
All the chapels.
All the windows.
The drapes.
All the leather.
All the lace.
All the forests.
All the flowers.
All the land.
All the grass.
The rocks.
The stone.
The pebbles.
The dirt.
The mud!
The mud!
I have a new destiny! One day I shall be king!
And I shall be queen!